From wherever and whenever you are, you're watching The Journal. This week, we explore the inner workings of a professional kitchen for some cultural eats and dive into the creative process for a Toronto tattoo artist.
We will also be exploring a Toronto broadcasting studio and to see what it takes to run your own dance studio.
Closing us off, we invited a special guest that maybe can teach us a few salsa steps.
You mean like the sauce, right? Because I'm hungry.
Yes, exactly.
Like Wait, seriously?
Oh my
God.
Let's
go.
Welcome to The Journal, a live studio broadcast from Centennial College's Story Arts Center produced by the students of the BNF program. We're your hosts, Maria Rodriguez.
And I'm Anthony Santilla. We hope you're ready to have some fun with us today. Starting us off, let's take a peek inside El Venezolano, a Venezuelan restaurant by Danforth Avenue. It's a place where people connect with great people as well as a plate of food.
Oof, that sounds amazing.
Hi, my name is Jose Carrillo, 34 years old, from Venezuela, come from a little town called Trujillo. I work at El Venezolano. Here we don't have like a set position. All of us do a little bit of everything. So I work either between the kitchen or in the front. Here at this location, I have been part of the team for a little bit over a year. This location has been here since 2018, and I helped the owners found it when they first started. Albert is like main owner. He went to school with my brother. I know him since he was in third grade, since he was like eight. So we are very multicultural. We have a lot of European influence, a lot of Spanish and Italians and Portuguese. I will say that our cuisine is very multicultural. For someone who is trying to understand our food or trying our food for the first time, we have a tasting platter called El Venezolanito, and it has many components of the main things of the menu. So it has two mini arepas, two mini cachapas, two mini tequeños, and two mini patacones. So you get like a two of everything. If you're coming with your family, you can get it, you can order it, taste it, try it, and then based on that, order the real size version of it.
Here we have our traditional plate back home. We call this one pabellón. It has black beans, shredded beef, tajadas, which is sweet fried plantains, and we have rice with epa. Cooking was something like new to me. Serving to people was new to me. So yeah, it's been a part of a journey for me working here and learning all of this. And now I see myself like at this time, and it's like wow, like I can do so many stuff and pass. And it's like it's nice to feel this way. And it's also very nice like to share part of my culture with people, to share my food with the people. And it's really nice to see not only people from my country or even my culture, like Latin people, like outside, like Canadian people, Chinese, anything.
Something that made me very proud is the smile on the staff, any of us, when you walk in there and you said, these customers told me that everything was amazing. You go there and you say that, or when I'm work, sometimes I work in the kitchen. So when I'm working in the kitchen, somebody comes here and tells me that, it's beautiful. Last night, I felt very proud. We had a table of six people. They were having a birthday party. And the lady, the wife of the birthday guy, was telling me that they were coming all the way from Ajax to come here, to eat here. Like, they made the reservation and they came from Ajax to eat here. That's something that is not the first time that happens. We have people coming from Oakville, Newmarket, Aurora, Ajax, Oshawa. We had a couple from Oshawa 2 nights ago. So when you see people saying they're coming that far away just to eat here, that's amazing.
Do you have any practical experience?
Any practical experience?
Any practical experience?
Yeah, I went to Centennial.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Doesn't everybody?
Oh, sorry. We couldn't resist trying some of the El Venezolano. They had tequinos from there. It's great.
I told you it was good.
Yeah, no, you weren't lying. Seriously, I loved it. I feel like I should get like an El Venezolano tattoo somewhere on me.
Oh yeah, that's a great idea. Well, but speaking about tattoos, have you ever thought about getting a tattoo yourself, Santia?
Yeah, I have. I mean, but honestly, I'd go to a professional. I would never try to do it because that's not right. But I know somebody that would. His name is Ali Tariq Awad. He runs a small tattoo business out of his own apartment in the Kensington Market.
Wow, yeah. That's amazing. Let's check it out.
I'm Ali Tariq Awad. I'm 29 years old, and I'm a tattoo artist. It's been like 14 months going on. It's been amazing, man. I've been able to support myself, create a connection with someone else, with other people through my art, not just doing it for the sake, or it kind of felt like very personal before, but now it feels like really connected, you know? When I'm doing a tattoo, it kind of keeps my intention in the right place because I know I want to only put what I believe in into someone else. I don't try to put myself in a box and put it to the side so I can make what people are enjoying or liking. I feel like I'm also giving them a piece of my life, and in that way we're connected. That's part of the tattoo, you know, that goes into it too, you know, whether this is my art or it's going into that person I'm gonna tattoo. So that's why I love tattooing, you know. It keeps me, it keeps you human, you know, keeps you humane, keeps you intention on the right path, you know.
I think tattooing myself, I think for people that tattoo themselves, it's a very personal thing just to do with your own self, to hurt yourself and to set an intention for yourself and to kind of sit with yourself and meditate through a tattoo and to just be reminded of it every time you see it. It's very beautiful.
I think the actual process is such a fucking drug. It's so fucking gnarly just, you know, just to cut up someone's skin, you know, and this, especially with these machines, you know, whatever medium you have, the idea that you're just pushing this ink into the skin and every moment it's just one poke.
tattooing myself and now Kiva's.
I was about to say, didn't you say that you were doing it yourself? That's right.
The idea that someone wants that you want to do that and someone wants to get their skin cut up for this thing. But I think the act of doing it and then the last like 20% of the tattoo is the best when you see it come to life and you start just making it perfect, you know, it's just such a fucking beautiful experience.
Ali is one uniquely talented guy. Centia?
Yeah, what?
What are you doing?
I was really inspired by the doc, so I wanted to, you know, try tattooing.
What even is that? It's
supposed to be a disco ball because you're so, like, groovy and stuff.
Aw, that's cute. That's
Thank
a cute
you,
touch.
Right?
It looks like a soccer ball, though.
Oh, God. Oh, I screwed up. Yeah, it does, but you know what? It's fine. It's, like, the same thing. Honestly, I've always wanted to get in sports broadcasting, so it works.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I think you'd be great at it. That gets me thinking, do you know what Canada is great for?
Oh yeah, hockey and soccer. Done, that's it.
I mean, yes, but I was going to say broadcasting because our next documentary will take us in the studio of CBC's The National.
Come on into The National.
My name's Steve Penny. I'm senior television director at CBC News. I'm sort of the last live director in news, so my other thing, as I'm chief news director, I do CBC News specials, like election shows. Remembrance Day in Ottawa, we were up there, and we're what we call the pool feed, right? So all the Canadian networks, CTV, City, Global, they take our pool coverage and put it out on their network.
I feel prideful in the fact that the students you are teaching will be, I guess, shaping the generation via broadcast?
I have a lot of pride. You can make me cry, because there's like, literally while we're walking up here, I have one who's down in the newsroom right now, ask me if I'm in. I have, and I'm proud to call them colleagues now, right? I've been doing it for so long. One of my first students applied for an internship in London way back in like 2010, I guess, was, well, she's now one of our head producers in London, England. She's been there ever since. I have students all over the country who work at the corporation, even in other jobs that I'm still connected to them with. So yeah, I certainly, it's not me who got them there, but I'm just proud of those students, basically, that they've come along and they do amazing work. They're absolutely fantastic. So for me, the whole teaching thing, it was a way just to share everything I learned here at the CBC about what we do, and to help share and also get the students prepared to enter a news business, right? Like what software we use for doing the news and the different type of jobs that we do here and which we've incorporated in our newsroom at Sheridan. So in a way, it's just to get students, yeah, prepared to tell those stories of Canadians once again, right? Yes, I'm sharing with them, but I also get a lot out of the students as well. And it keeps me young and engaged, basically. One of our number one mission statements is reflecting the stories of Canadians. So yes, that's it. I mean, the CBC itself, that is its mandate, right? That we don't show American programming and stuff like that. We are here for Canadian, as the Canadian broadcast, to tell Canadian stories across the country. So yeah, the National, it's always been, you know, since the 60s or 50s, even farther back, the newscast of record, some will call it, sort of thing, the flagship newscast, certainly the public broadcasters. And it, you know, in so much that we tell the stories of Canadians and strive to do that, you know, accurately and correctly and diversely as possible. I would say, yeah, that's, we're at least trying to reflect the Canadian culture, if not, you know, be part of it.
You know, Maria, we do get a little taste of what it's like working in a studio here, but like that setup is just on another level. It's crazy.
You're right though. Did you see all those screens in the control room? I wouldn't know where to look, like one when I here, one I there. Crazy.
Well, you know, how about we ask somebody that actually helped working on the doc? Let's welcome Ian, our guest, who, like I previously stated, helped make this documentary.
Hi there.
Welcome, Ian.
Hi, hello.
Tell us, how did you feel being in this studio?
Just like a level of stress, you know, just there was, as you said, like there's just so much going on in the control room. We do get a little taste of that in the BNF program at Centennial, but it's just like the control room here at the school times 10, you know, and it's it's overwhelming, but kind of awestruck, you know.
So, Ian, what was the most interesting part of exploring the set at the National and speaking with Steve?
It was a good chance to see like all the facilities and how the National works, how CBC kind of runs their studio. It was really interesting, and Steve kind of said in the doc how they built the show and the programming to better reflect the culture of Canada and Canadians and their stories, just because I feel like that's just something that needs to be done. It's super important.
For sure. Do you see yourself working in a live studio like that in the future?
maybe, just because just thinking back to the control room, thinking back to the studio space, I know I would be good with audio, but I don't, it's a lot to think about, though. I want to kind of leave myself open to that, you know?
Totally.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Ian, for your insights.
Our last story of the day focuses on an amazing performer. Dracer Garcia moved from Cuba to Canada, but didn't leave his passion for dancing behind.
Cinco. Then from here, I'm going on a basic 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Michael Jackson.
I'm Dracer Garcia. My profession is I'm a dancer, but these days I'm a director of a company. I'm the owner of a Dre Dance Academy, and yeah, a lot of things on the way. I'm coming from Cuba. Born there, and I came here when I was like 27 years old. It's been like 10 years here in Canada. What I was doing there, I was a professional dancer, actually. I started dancing when I was 12 years old, and since then, nonstop. When I started teaching salsa, this was something from when I was dancing in the American theater. And this company would have a project that we would do for the community, for the youth around the area, and they said to me in the company that I had to teach these workshops. And it was fun because you learn how to deal with people, how to teach, how to explain. It's no easy, it's something really tricky. But well, I learned and I started doing that back in when I was like 18 years old, 2006, 2007, something like that. Then after that, I started working in Cayo Largo del Sur. It's like an island down in Cuba. It's a tourism, for tourism. And there, I started teaching tourists how to dance salsa, cha-cha-cha, mambo, pilon, this, that. And it was really fun. It was really fun. I really enjoyed this teaching process.
Dre is like, his energy is contagious. He
he's always here, so you get used to him. So he's very reliable because he's always here. He barely takes a time off work. And when he's not here, like for the odd class, like you miss him. So that's how you really know, oh, I really like coming to Dre's, and Dre's a really great teacher.
When I got here, I didn't know too many people. I was like kind of alone in the field. And I started looking for people that dance and have dance school and this and that. But well, I went to Salsa and Sinclair, and there I talked to Jennifer O'Coin. She's one of the biggest business owner of Salsa and all this stuff here in Toronto. And she said, yeah, come and teach with us. And well, I wanted to be seen in the dance community. And yeah, it was fun. But after 3 years, when I thought that the Salsa community knew a little bit about me, I decided to open my own school. Wasn't the lowest point of my life back in those days. I was doing construction in the side, I was dancing. Then, yes, I decided to open the studio. Once I opened the studio, everything changed. Everything was a little more excited because I was doing what I want. But still, I was doing construction during the day and I was dancing at night. It was a big toll on my body because I was working like crazy amount of hours. I moved to this place in 2019, and there everything changed for the good and for the bad, because when COVID came, things were interesting. But well, we survived COVID, and here we are, Dre Dance Academy, still.
Wow, I really like to learn those moves. That was amazing.
You know what? I never thought I would say this, but I actually, like, I love Latin music, and I actually want to see if my hips can move like that.
Well, maybe our special guest can be your dance teacher. We invited Dracer Garcia and his dance partner, Maria Zambrano, to show us how it's done. Welcome, Dre and Maria. Woo-hoo. Yeah. Welcome, guys.
Thank you so
welcome,
much.
Welcome.
Thanks for the invitation.
Yeah, no, thank you for coming to the show. I got a couple questions for you guys. Do you have any advice for somebody who wants to start learning salsa?
It's just passion. If you want to dance, you can do it. Then
totally.
You can show up at the studio and do it. Who cares?
And practice.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about your routine. What does it take to be a dance performer?
Well, a lot of dedication. More than anything, a lot of work, a lot of training, then yeah, it's a lot of push through.
Yeah.
A lot of years, I would say.
Any special diets that you need to take?
No, I really don't take any diets. I eat everything and anything. I love actually el venezolano that I hear about it.
Oh, there we go, then, some tequeños. Go.
Now, Dre, another yes. question for you. Does a man always lead in salsa dancing, or can the woman?
No, it's depend of the preference of everybody.
Okay.
Then back in the day, it was more like the leader would be the male and the female, you know, the follower. But these days, everybody is welcome to lead or follow. It's depending on the preference of anyone.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
And finally, like, do you need to dance a lot with your partner to get to know each other? How long have you been dancing together?
Actually, Maria is a new addition to the company.
Amazing.
And we've been working together for the past maybe like 2-3 months.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Well, can't wait to see it. So take it away, Dre and Maria.
There we go. It's dance. Woo!
sombra del hispano, en salir a vacilar, se reúnen en la barriada, dejando atrás sus labores.
Y se van para las villas, echando rumba, señores. Y se van para las villas, echando rumba, señores.
Y los que no salen, se quedan con sus colegas, vacilando en la bodega.
Thank you for that performance. It was really, really fun spending time with you guys. Thank you, thank you. Thanks again. Once again, let's hear it for Dreister and Maria.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.
Have a beautiful day.
You too.
Thank you.
Well, that's all the time we have for today, folks. I hope you had a great time watching. Once again, we're Maria and Santia.
And I'm Anthony Santia. Don't forget it.
I just said that. Well, this has been The Journal, and we're signing off. Bye-bye.
I didn't know what to do, but Centennial College guided me. Story Arts Center gave me so much more than I expected. Being here gave me many opportunities, like being industry connected. But those connections will always lead me back to my community here. Well, that's our story. What would yours be?
Cut. That was amazing.